high tide. And as we look out at the Long Island Sound, and we visualize what is ahead with 75 feet of beach in front of Glenn Lascos' house here, this is a project that's a long time coming. And unfortunately, way too many pictures of literally decades where storms have adversely impacted Hashomomuck Cove in a way that has caused extensive damage. It's caused great threat and harm to County Road 48. It has caused great risk to the hospitals, nursing homes, daycare centers that are east of here. This is a very long time coming and an important morning for all of you to be here and an important process for everyone here to participate in. On August 12, 2016, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers released the draft integrated feasibility report and environmental assessment, which outlines the proposed coastal storm risk management project for Hashomomuck Cove in Southold. The proposed project, which is currently estimated to cost $17,749,000, would encompass 1.5 miles of developed coast on the Long Island Sound, including 58 residential structures and 2 commercial structures. This stretch of land is heavily prone to substantial overwashing and erosion during coastal storms. Completion of this project is not only important to protect homes and businesses, but also to safeguard our infrastructure, including County Road 48, a critical roadway for transportation, the economy, as well as a critical evacuation route in the event of an emergency. This project is not just important to complete before the next tropical storm or hurricane is to hit. A severe thunderstorm mixed with high tide, which could happen at any time, could lead to serious property destruction and the loss of County Road 48. The proposed project is broken down into 3 parts: West Cove, Central Cove, and East Cove. It includes plans to build a 25-foot berm in the West Cove, a variable width berm between 25 to 75 feet in the Central Cove, and a 25-foot berm in the East Cove. Overall, 160,000 cubic yards of sand would fill the coastline, including 34,000 cubic yards in the West Cove, 56,000 cubic yards in the Central Cove, and 70,000 cubic yards in the East Cove. The initial planning and engineer costs will be covered 100% federally. The initial construction cost share will be 65% federal, with a 35% non-federal partner at another level of government. The cost of renourishment over the long term 50-year life of the project will be shared 50% federal and 50% non-federal. I will continue working with the Army Corps, town, county, and state officials to finalize funding plans for this project. 65% cost share borne by the federal government is already funded. Over the next few weeks, I very strongly encourage the public to participate in the public comment period, which is now open. I was vocal with the Army Corps that holding any public hearing in late August is unfair to the many Southold residents out of town at that time, and that the hearing should take place in September. We have now been informed that the public hearing has been scheduled for Southold Town Hall the evening of September 19th. I will keep you all informed when the time is confirmed. Residents can also submit public comments by mail or email. The address is Miss Judith Johnson, the project biologist, at the New England District Corps of Engineers, 696 Virginia Road, Concord, Massachusetts, 01742-2751. The email address is judith.l.johnson@usace.army.mil. The public comment period was previously set to end on September 16th, but with the scheduling of the public comment hearing on September 19th, the comment period has been extended to September 30th. Once the public comment period closes, all of the public comments will be considered for incorporation in a final report and submitted to the Army Corps Chief for his approval by April 2017. The current scheduled timeline is that a project partnership agreement will be executed with the non-federal sponsor by July 2017, and the contract will be awarded by January of 2018. Construction is then expected to begin in 2018. The tentative timeline for construction is estimated to take approximately 7 to 10 months. As a member of the House Transportation Infrastructure Committee, in an effort to ensure its completion in 2018, it's my priority to get this plan attached to the next Water Resources and Development Act, otherwise known as WRDA, W-R-D-A. This legislation approves of Army Corps projects. By including this plan in WRDA, the project will be officially signed off on by Congress. Again, the 65% federal share is already approved. The details of the project would be included in WRDA. I would like to thank the Army Corps for their efforts. I would strongly ask that they give the highest consideration to the priorities which will be outlined by the elected officials, the residents gathered here today, as well as the many residents who will hopefully participate in this public comment period. This project is so important to the Hashomomuck Cove community, which is why it is so important that the public be heavily engaged in this process over the next few weeks. Additionally, in a closing thought, in order to keep this project on pace with its current scheduled timeline, we need to work with our state officials, working very closely with our town and county officials who have placed the highest priority in seeing this project is completed, to do whatever we can to secure the 35% non-federal share, working with all of our partners in government at all the different levels that I had just outlined. I am honored to introduce our first speaker. He's the person who brought this project to my attention before I was even in Congress. I can vouch for how much of the highest priority he has placed on this effort, which is obviously not just a long time coming, but literally decades coming. Supervisor Russell.
First of all, I want to say this is a project that has been years in the making. Short tenure in office, look how much progress we've made. And I want to thank Representative Zeldin for all the efforts to get this far so quickly for us. I also want to thank Glenn, who has been a real champion for the community that's here today. As I told the reporter once, Glenn is very efficient at getting a hold of Southfold is a coastal community, and threats to our coastline are threats to our entire community. That's how vital this project is. It's under some of the most severe threat of all the coastal areas of this town. It needs our help, it needs our attention, and we can't wait to get started and to do what's best for all the people that are here today. Thank you.
Thank you, Supervisor Russell. I want to note that we are being joined this morning by Southfold Town Councilwoman Jill Doherty, Southfold Trustee Nick Krupski, and Southfold Town Councilman Jim Denizio. At this time, I'd like to introduce Trustee Krupski to say a few words.
Hello, everyone. as South Cove Town Trustee, just like to say, I'll be happy to work with the Army Corps to go through the project and make sure this gets done right to protect the road, the utilities, and the homeowners here. One thing I'd just like to point out is that when you add sand to the nerves of beach, it's very important to stabilize the sand. And I'd really like to see some beach land really pop up in the communal area. All I have, thank you.
I'd like to introduce Councilwoman Gordon.
This is just, it's exciting for me as it is for Lynn, because when I was a trustee, we came to the trustee office and said, what do we do? And we worked with her and we said, this is bigger than the town can handle. And we pulled in Ed Romaine, who started the ball rolling and pointed Lynn in the right direction to, as Scott Russell says, to be very efficient, to keep it on the front of the office. And if it wasn't for Lynn, gotten to the point where we pulled in Lee Zeldin, and if it wasn't for Lee, we wouldn't be standing here today. And so I just want to thank the everybody involved, that the efforts, everything, it's little or big, that's what it takes, a community to see a project like this. And you know, it's exciting that it's actually
It's also important to note for way of background that the life of this project, it's a 50-year project. As I mentioned earlier, it's 50% federal, 50% non-federal. That is for the maintenance of this project long-term for the next half of a century. So the 100% federal funding for the initial design engineering, that is all paid for. The 65% for the construction of this project, that is appropriated and funded. The 50% federal share for that half a century maintaining the project is something that continuously over the course of the next many decades, we will continue to have to advocate for both the federal partner and the non-federal partner to continue to secure that 50%. The good news is that cost for that maintenance is drastically less than this construction is. So that is the good news there, but I just wanted to point that out for the members of the media who are here. I believe that takes us to our host this morning. And you know, she really does speak not just with a very personal story of how this project is needed for her property and her neighbor's property, but on behalf of literally dozens of residents who are here, business owners, concerned residents of South Hold who may not even live here, but know how important County Road 48 is. I think that her passion and advocacy for this, not just on behalf of her and her neighbors, but for everyone who's gathered here, is something to be commended. And I'm looking forward to hearing for Lynn, who I'm sure is speaking on behalf of a very motivated and inspired and proud community. Lynn Laskos.
Hi again, my name is Lynn Laskos, and I'm the spokesman for Hashomomuck Cove Families. We have been working on this project for over 12 years. The families and I would like to first thank Congressman Zeldin for taking this up and over the top and making it today. Scott Russell, who has never left us, who has always been with us, and we appreciate it. Jill from Trustee and Councilman, and Jim Tizio, and Bill Paul, all of you who have just always been with us. Nick, you're a newcomer, but you'll be here at the end of the day. My family's been part of the Cove since the early 1960s, and when my family first purchased this home, no, I wasn't born in 1960, we had over 150 feet of beachfront property in front of the house. Throughout our years, our homes have been the buffer to County Road 48, and without our homes, we probably would have washed out the road by now. Hurricane Carol, Dave Corwin would know, in 1954 actually reached through the homes and everybody opened their doors and the water went straight across 48 into what was a potato field behind us. So, and that's with 150 feet of today we have about 38 feet at high tide to the county line. And when the wind isn't blowing, like this past Tuesday and it wasn't a storm, we were down to 11 feet, which actually is right here where the end of my bulkhead is. It's the beginning of county property. It's not if, but when the road washes out due to a storm, it will paralyze transportation, wash out the gas and water mains that run to the east end. So this isn't just about our homes, but this is about a road that everybody uses, including the ferries, the ambulance, the police, and just us. We welcome the draft feasibility study, and we're looking forward to the commitments from the local sponsors. And again, it's been a long haul, and I thank you all.
What's a very important message that the elected officials all want to bring to the local residents is to participate in this public comment period. This is an opportunity for the Army Corps to hear everything that you like or you want to see changed. It's up to you individually to decide how you want to weigh in, but it's important not just for Hashomomuck Cove residents to participate in this public comment period. While we've been here during this press conference, we have had all sorts of traffic passing on County Road 48, relying on this road as a lifeline, a transportation lifeline that gets them past this point. And for all of that traffic that has passed during this press conference and passes every single day, it's important for you to weigh in as well. Because if you value County Road 48, you must participate, and the Army Corps needs to hear from you in order to ensure that this project stays on timeline and that the Army Corps doesn't sense any complacency whatsoever by anyone in the community. Now is not a time to let up. It's a time to bring this home and get this done. So thank you all for being here. Please participate in the public comment period. I'm happy to answer any questions from the media. This project is funded 65% federal, and that is the law and the appropriation federally. So now is an important time where every elected official at every level of government is going to have to get together and figure out where the other 35% is going to come from. Fortunately, when you look at the number, it's a lot bigger of a number for a town. You know, if you said Southall Town on its own needed to come up with the money, that is an unreasonable position, I believe, to place that burden. What I do think is important, though, is that for every level of government, including the federal sponsor, to sit down and figure out where this other 35% is going to come from, because it really, in a big scheme of things, is not a lot of money. It's a lot of money if you say Southall Town on its own needs to come up with it. That would be a lot of money. But if all of the different levels of government came together to figure out where the non-federal money is going to come from, that number doesn't look as big. When you're dealing with other levels of government with bigger budgets, and also, you know, the county right now is has an important role to play, obviously. State legislators, the governor, the New York State DC, they have the biggest budget, but we just all need to get together and figure out how to get it done. Failure is not an option. This is something that has to get done, and has to get done on schedule. I do know that this is a project that is all over the state, county radar. If you ask the state legislators, if you ask the executives, if you ask the New York State DEC, they are very well aware of the non-federal portion that needs to be secured. So I don't think that there's any learning curve whatsoever in sitting down and having that conversation to figure out where the other 35% comes from. Again, in the big scheme of things, when you start looking at different levels of other levels of government and the size of your budgets, Yeah, I can have it here. You all handle me. I'm going to grab the car. I'll get the exact number, go ahead.
Would you ever look for any corporate sponsorships? Corporate engagement?
Corporate?
Yeah.
I don't know if that is an option.
I'm just wondering if that is.
I got it. I don't know if that's an option.
The private sector has an interest in it. It might be an option.
That's something that we'll go to the Army Corps with and then get back to you. If there are any private donors out there listening, all kidding aside, I'm not here to solicit that at this moment, but what I will do is ask the Army Corps if that's an option and get back to you. Okay, so here are the numbers. So the total cost, as I mentioned earlier, $17,736,000. The project cost, the initial construction, the federal share is $8,767,200. Non-federal share is $2,275,800 for a total cost of $11,043,000. There is a real estate cost, non-federal, that is currently budgeted at $2,445,000. The beach renourishment, this is the continuing construction. The federal share is $2,124,000, which is 50% federal, 50% non-federal. As I mentioned, this maintenance cost over the life of the project is a lot less than that initial cost. But to break down the non-federal share, it's $4,720,800. Is the non-federal, and then you have the non-federal 50% maintenance cost for the next 50 years. Yeah, a little noisy. Any other questions for me now? Which part?
The 35%.
Absolutely, the 35%, you have many different options for a non-federal partner. It is important as a next step for everyone, federal partners, non-federal partners, every level of government, to brainstorm every possible way to secure the other 35%, because it is not an option not to complete this project. This is, even if someone out there was heartless and not understanding how these homes serve as barriers for County Road 48, even if people were ignoring that reality and they were just looking at County Road 48, that alone justifies the need to finish this project on time.
It has to be in place by, would you say,
July of 2017 is when the non-federal partner would be signed under the current timeline. Any other questions for media? Okay, just one or two quick questions from residents. Go ahead.
Being a resident, I'm right here. I'm seeing it, but the power line is right here. And this Monday, we had so much wind and we're right here. This is so dangerous. What are you guys doing now before all this whole project going back to the government? What is it being done now? I look at the power line. Obviously, power line versus the 48 and everything else is so dangerous.
Well, this is what we are doing now is trying to bring home what is a long-term solution to ensure that all of the pictures that the ambassador on her property, that we don't see another 60 years worth of pictures of this situation getting worse and worse. So that is why this project is on a timeline and it's on right now, which really needs to, and your point is very well taken, to echo why this needs to be completed as quickly and as effectively as possible. If it was, if I could have my way, you could have your way. I mean, I have a white t-shirt on too. We would start doing the construction at the end of this press conference.
That's being so dangerous.
Because, you know, it's absolutely. This is something that should have been done a long time ago.
All right, thank you.
Yep. And there was one other question.
I was curious, there's a lot of talk about it. I'm wondering if there are any strings attached to taking that money.
Yeah, one of the key components of this project, this study was completed by the Army Corps of Engineers. So as you look through the study, everything in there is a product of the Army Corps doing. If there was another level of government that was responsible for putting this study together, maybe something would look a little bit differently. But because the Army Corps is responsible for the project, and because the federal government, we are appropriating 65% of this funding and literally issuing the A-plus figures, because of that, you have a study that is filled with different parameters as they exist today, related to length of berms, heights of dunes. Right now you have a public access point with the East Cove because of the South Old Town Beach. There is a public access point that will have to be designated, one in the Central Cove and one in the Eastern Cove. But this isn't a final draft. And anything that you read, and by the way, I would encourage anyone to read this study, anything that you see in here that you want to approve of, be vocal of, to say keep that, that's good. Or something else you want to weigh in and maybe ask for something additional or modification. Now's the time. There's no better time than right now. The public comment period is scheduled to end on September 30th. And it is scheduled to be signed off on by the Army Corps Chief by April of 2017. All right, one last question.
One quick question. Because it's being done by the Army Corps, what about cost overruns? Did that fall back to the 35%?
Well,
saying 18 million, but listen, we all know construction. It starts at 18, it'll end up at 30.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that I've noticed, and listen, the jury will always be out when you're talking about a project that's not yet completed. But what I've noticed, especially with the work on the Fire Island to Montauk Point plan, is that the Army Corps, the system is set up to come in under budget. Because everything goes out to bid, and whoever secures the winning bid, they are given incentives to complete a project within a timeline and to come in under budget. That is one of the best ways for them to secure a future contract, is to complete this project as effectively and on time and under budget. So at this point, we're not worried about cost overruns. If this project doesn't stay on the timeline that it's on right now, and you start dealing in hypotheticals that it's a disservice for us to start talking about. But we're talking about 2016, 2018 numbers. We don't want to have another conversation where we are talking about 2024 numbers.
We won't be here.
Exactly. So we aren't even going to talk in hypotheticals. But as far as my experience with the Army Corps of Engineers and the way this budgeting is done, it is done to come in under budget with these numbers, not to come over. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.